very warm welcome to all of you to Coventry Cathedral for this special service of choral evensong for the Friends of the Holy Land on this United Nations International Day of Peace. Our hearts and minds are full, of course, not only of images from the Holy Land, from Israel-Palestine, but also we gather very much to pray for the situation across Europe and in other parts of the world that God has placed especially on our own hearts and minds. We welcome very warmly a variety of representatives of those who feel a common cause with this desire to see the Holy Land flourish. Particularly, we look forward to our address from Bishop Christopher, the Bishop of Coventry, to the prayers from Archbishop Bernard Longley, the Archbishop of Birmingham. Please do plan to stay behind after the service for refreshments. We're going to have a short address, I understand, from Brendan Metcalf, who is the Executive Director of the Friends of the Holy Land, with a little bit more information about their work. Please do plan, of course, to visit the exhibition to have a look at the 50 Faces exhibition, which helps us to greet one another in shared humanity. We'd also love to encourage you to meet, if you have not done already, our Sue McClellan, who is our curate here at the cathedral, but in her day job is the church's engagement lead for Embrace the Middle East. So it's wonderful to have Sue sharing in the ministry here. I'd love to go on at more length about our ministry here in the cathedral, but do please ask us about the reconciliation ministry as you come, as we gather at the end of the service. And do please make sure, if you've not seen it before, that you see our wonderful cathedral font, which is a very physical and visceral connection for us coming, as it does, from a hillside between Bethlehem and Hebron. So once again, an incredibly warm welcome to this service of choral evensong as we gather in prayer, in thanksgiving, but also petition for that very special part of our world.
Thank you. The first lesson is from the fourth chapter of the book of Micah, starting to read at the first verse. In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised up above the hills. Peoples shall stream to it, and many nations shall come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth instruction, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between many peoples, and shall arbitrate between strong nations far away. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. But they shall all sit under their own vines and under their own fig trees, and no one shall make them afraid. For the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken." Here ends the lesson.
Thank you. second lesson is from Matthew 5, verses 1 to 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the poor in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you, falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Here ends the lesson.
Believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear friends, we gather on this United Nations International Day of Peace at a time when there is the highest number of wars and conflicts across the world has known since 1945. We meet when there is that which we thought we would never see again, war in Europe. We meet on the day when we woke up to hear that there has been a partial mobilization in Russia. There are to be referenda in four areas of occupied Ukraine. We meet at a time when conflict simmers incessantly in the Holy Land, where injustice continues, where fear reigns, where hatred ferments, and where peace eludes, and where we know that at least some, maybe many, of the world's tensions and conflicts are rooted in some way in the irresolution of conflict in the Holy Land. And that is why we are called to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Just a few years ago, before Archbishop Hossan, the Anglican Archbishop of Jerusalem, a little while before he was made bishop, while he was still dean, and I was with him at a gathering of the whole diocese in Jordan, and I took one of my young colleagues with me, and they had a really good conversation. We were in Jordan, and we'd been hearing about the experience of the Diocese of Jerusalem in its different parts of the Holy Lands. And my colleague said to the then dean, how do you keep going in all of this? How do you maintain your hope? And he said, well, how can we not have hope in the city in which Jesus Christ was raised from the dead? There is much to give us hope in our readings today. There are no ifs and buts here in the prophecy. In the days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills. Nations shall come to it and say, let us come to the mountain of the Lord. God shall judge between the peoples, and shall arbitrate between strong nations far away. This is what God will do. And this is what we will do as that judgment comes and manifests itself throughout the earth. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into prunicles. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation. Neither shall they learn war anymore. Therein lies our hope. In the prophecy that comes from the word of the Lord, that we see fulfilled in Jesus as he rises from the dead. Peace will come. But there is work for us to do as a world in the meantime to prepare the way for the coming of that peace. to allow the conditions for God to bring that peace. That it is God's will and way to bring. Neither shall they learn war anymore. Our reading from the New Testament, from Matthew's Gospel, tells us something about the dispositions, the attitudes, the behaviors that are needful of humanity in order to learn no longer the ways of war, but to learn the ways of peace. I've been wondering for a while where Jesus learnt those attitudes, those dispositions of peace, whether they just came to him, as it were, whether he wrestled with them as he wrestled with Scripture, or whether he saw them in people, whether he saw them in anyone in particular. And I share this with you as a little bit of speculation, but I think it has a basis. That Jesus saw these dispositions, these attitudes lived out in his mother. Where did Jesus learn about this disposition of being poor in spirit and then comforted? Surely in the lowly one who found herself exalted. Where did Jesus learn about what it might mean to be persecuted? Perhaps from the one who was told that her son would be a sign to be opposed. Where did Jesus learn about this disposition of thirsting, hungering for righteousness, the righteousness that creates the conditions of peace? Well, perhaps from the one who sang about the hungry being filled and the empty being sent, and the rich being sent empty away. Where did Jesus learn that the pure in heart shall see God? Perhaps from the one who was pure in heart and indeed saw and touched God made flesh. So I venture to speculate that Jesus learned something about what it means to be a peacemaker from his own mother. His own mother in his family, in their community. Perhaps even in the community of the church as it began to grow around him. I was in Armenia a little while ago, where there has been an overlooked conflict, a very nasty and cruel, brutal, short, but ghastly. Last week it flared up again. I saw a mother at the military graveyard. She was holding on to the tombstone of her son. People were trying to pull her away. She was weeping and wailing. Searing pain. was shattering her soul. We know there are mothers throughout the world, in Ukraine right now and in Russia. who feel the pain of war with an intensity, because the life to which they have given life, the life which they have, that has been conceived within them, formed within them, that they have nurtured, tended, has been taken away through the violence of war. And many of us will have seen that pain etched on the faces of people in the Holy Land. My prayer on this International Day of Peace is for all mothers, all of those who intimately form the life of lives, especially perhaps the mothers who have experienced that searing pain of their children being taken away through conflict and violence. That they will find a way to nurture and form life that is not ruled by hatred. But is committed to the preservation of life. And I pray also for all of us, that we too will have that mothering instinct that looks first to life and all that preserves life, all that protects life, all that finds a way through the conflicts, tensions, the difficulties that drive people into conflict and into violence. And I pray for mothers, Palestinian and Jewish, that they will be bearers of peacemakers and formers of peacemakers. And I pray for the church in the Holy Land. And this is why the work of the Friends of the Holy Land is so important, and every other body, every other group, every other agency that is trying to do as the Friends are, bring hope and sustenance and future to these vulnerable communities. For the Church in the Holy Land, in all her forms, is called to be a mother of peace. Is called to support the way of peace. Is called to help people of every background learn no longer the ways of war, but the ways of peace. Church which gives Christ birth again in the Holy Land, the Prince of Peace. That the Holy Land will once again, Israel, Palestine, will be a land of peace, and that there will be peace in Jerusalem. Let us pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Let us give thanks for the life of the church throughout that holy land. Pray that after the manner of Mary, the church may give birth to peace through through Christ our Lord.
Let us stand and pray. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The hatred which divides nation from nation, race from race, class from class, Father, forgive. The covetous desires of people and nations to possess what is not their own, Father, forgive. The greed which exploits the work of human hands and lays waste the earth,
Father, forgive.
Our envy of the welfare and happiness of others,
Father,
our indifference to the plight of the imprisoned, the homeless, the refugee. The lust which dishonors the bodies of men, women, and children. The pride which leads us to trust in ourselves and not in God. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Together we pray. Almighty Father, faithful God, bless our brothers and sisters in the land of the Holy One. Grant peace in that land, peace in their homes, and peace in their hearts. Inspire the friends of the Holy Land to build on your foundations of justice, mercy, and peace. As partners with our Christian brothers and sisters, give to pilgrims a new vision of your kingdom. Fill them with compassion and love. Keep the cries of this land in our hearts. This we pray in the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ. Amen.
Dear friends, may I say what a joy it is that this service is happening today, and how good it is that the Friends of the Holy Land is an ecumenical body. I believe Archbishop began as a Roman Catholic initiative, and generously Anglicans were invited to be part of it, formally, I think, and I know other Christians are also part of it. It's always a special joy for me to be with Archbishop Bernard. We were not quite on holiday together, but we spent over 2 weeks in the warmth of summer at the Lambeth Conference, and Archbishop Bernard is much loved by not only the Church of England, but by the whole Anglican Communion through his work in the Anglican Roman Catholic International Commission. And that was proved, I think, not only in the affection to you, Archbishop at Lambeth, but your patient endurance through those many days with us. We deeply appreciated that. So I've done a little deal with the Archbishop, and I've asked him whether he would give us his blessing this evening in this cathedral church. And I would be honored, Archbishop, if you were to give your blessing.
Christopher, for the blessings of the Lambeth Conference and for your kindness tonight and for your words. The love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. The joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.